Good morning, church, and welcome to worship on this Lord's Day. I greet you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. As we move into our service of worship for this morning, I want to remind you of a couple of matters that help facilitate this virtual worship. One is that during the service, and the sooner the better, if you are on by Zoom or Facebook, we invite you to put in the chat any joys or concerns that you'd like to have lifted in prayer. So you can go ahead and do that. And as I said, the sooner the better, the closer to the prayer time, we might not be able to pick those up and incorporate them. Also, during the time of offering, you can either sit and reflect upon your gifts to God and God's gifts to you, or you can write the check that you will later put in the mail, or go to lakearrowheadchurch.com and press on the Give button in the top right-hand corner or to the right of the menu, and that will take you to a place where you can give online. So, all of that said, let us prepare our hearts and minds to worship God. Let us join in the call to worship. Praise the Lord. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Who can utter the mighty doings of the Lord or declare all his praise? Happy are those who observe justice, who do righteousness at all times. Let us worship God, and we will begin our worship with singing the hymn, Sing Praise to God Who Reigns Above. And now Carol Johnstone has our scripture reading.
Reading is from the book of Philippians, chapter 4, verses 1 through 9. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved. I urge Euodia and I urge Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you also, my loyal companion, help these women, for they have struggled beside me in the work of the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be in you.
Friends, Scripture tells us that if we say we are without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Therefore, let us join together and confess our sins before God. Let us pray. Eternal God, you have given us so much, especially you have given us the gift of yourself in Jesus Christ. And we pray, oh God, that you will open our hearts and minds to the ways in which our lives have fallen short of your glory. We confess that so often, especially in fear, we forsake you, we abandon your call to love and to forgiveness, your call to graciousness and grace-filled living. Hear now our silent prayers of confession. Forgive us, merciful God, and renew a true and good and right spirit within us. Delight yourself with your grace being manifested in love in our lives for the sake of the world and for the sake of your glory. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life is gone and a new life has begun. Friends, believe that good news and let us say it together. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Let us join in the Gloria Patri. I'm going to try to make something. So if the children will join me and watch and maybe see what I'm going to make. Now these are, do you know what these are? Yeah, wiki sticks. They stick together. Well, I'm going to try to make something as I tell you about Moses and about God and the people of Israel. You see, Moses, as you know, had led the people of Israel out of Egypt where they were slaves, and they passed through the Red Sea, and they were in the wilderness. And it was hard living in the wilderness, but God was with them. And God gave them food and gave them water. But then one day, Moses went up the mountain to talk with God. And when Moses went up the mountain, it took a long time for him to come back. And they waited for him. And they waited. And they waited. And he still didn't come back. And so the people of Israel got scared. They didn't realize they were going to have to wait so long. And they started to think maybe Moses wouldn't come back. So they said, if Moses isn't with us, God's not with us. And so we need to make our own God. And so they went to Aaron, Moses' brother, who made them a golden calf. And they said, this is our God who brought us out of the land of Egypt. And they worshiped it and celebrated. But God wasn't very happy with this. It really upset God. As a matter of fact, God said, I'm going to do something bad to these people for what they did. But God, in the end, God didn't. God said, Moses said, you don't want to do something bad to them. Then everybody will say that you only set them free in order to do something bad. So God decided, no, they are still my people, and I will still be with them and love them and be faithful to them, even if they haven't really loved me. Well, sometimes we make our little golden calves. What I mean by that is we think that God has left us or doesn't care anymore, and we decide that we need to take matters into our own hands. But what the story reminds us is that God comes, and God is with us, and God loves us even when we can't see it, even when we can't seem to remember that God loves us. So, we don't need golden calves because we have God. We have the God whom we know in Jesus, who died for us, who rose for us, who prays for us, and is with us all the time. Let's pray. Gracious God, thank you for giving us Jesus. Thank you for giving us stories about golden calves and your giving yourself. And help us to always remember that you love us and that you will never leave us. In Jesus' name, amen. And now, as we turn to the scriptures, Let us turn to God with the prayer for illumination. Spirit of God, shine your light upon the reading of this your word, and with our hearing, enlighten our hearts with fresh understanding. Amen. Well, I'm going to read to you the story from the book of Exodus that contains the story I was talking about just now. The making of the golden calf at Moses' delay from returning from the mountain. I want to mention to you an issue of translation. The word that, or one of the words that gets translated God in the Hebrew scriptures is Elohim. And most of the time when we see Elohim, we read it gets translated God. But Elohim is really a plural form and would most literally be translated gods. And what happens is, in Hebrew, they would use the plural form in order to talk about the singular subject of God or person of God in a magnificent way, you know, in a way that spoke of God's majesty and greatness. So you would use the plural form to speak of something singular in a way to reflect its greatness. So that's what happens here. So some translations say, these are your gods, and some say, this is your God. I'm going to read it, these are your gods, as it is in this translation, but I really think it means, this is your God. I hope that makes sense. When the people saw, this is chapter 32 of the book of Exodus, verses 1 through 14. When the people saw that Moses delayed to come down from the mountain, he's up the mountain receiving the Ten Commandments, receiving instructions about building the tabernacle, their mobile tent worship space, the precursor to the temple. When the people saw that Moses delayed to come down from the mountain, the people gathered around Aaron and said to him, "Come, make gods for us who shall go before us. As for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him." Aaron said to them, "Take off the gold rings that are on your ears and the ears of your wives and your sons and your daughters and bring them to me." So all the people took off the gold rings from their ears and brought them to Aaron. He took the gold from them, formed it in a mold, and cast an image of gold of a calf. And they said, "These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt." When Aaron saw this, he built an altar before it. And Aaron made proclamation and said, "Tomorrow shall be a festival to the Lord." They rose early the next day and offered burnt offerings and brought sacrifices of well-being. And the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to revel. The Lord said to Moses, "Go down at once, your people, whom you brought up out of the land of Egypt, have acted perversely. They have been quick to turn aside from the way that I commanded them. They have cast for themselves an image of a calf and have worshipped it and sacrificed to it and said, 'These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt.'" The Lord said to Moses, "I have seen this people, how stiff-necked they are. Now let me alone so that my wrath may burn hot against them and I may consume them. And of you, I will make a great nation." But Moses implored the Lord his God and said, O Lord, why does your wrath burn hot against your people, whom you brought out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say, it was with evil intent that he brought them out to kill them in the mountains and to consume them from the face of the earth? Turn from your fierce wrath, change your mind, and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, Israel, your servants, how you swore to them by your own self, saying to them, I will multiply your descendants like the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have promised, I will give to your descendants, and they shall inherit it forever. And the Lord changed his mind about the disaster that he planned to bring on his people. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will endure forever. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. We are in a time of wilderness these days in church life or in the life of our society and nation and maybe world too. I guess so, with a pandemic. And we experience the theme of wilderness in a way that is perhaps greater than any one of us, collectively at least, has experienced it. In this time in which our nation, our society, is in a kind of wilderness period. And maybe we can understand and engage and reflect upon Israel's time in the wilderness in ways that we've never been able to before. The Israelites are waiting at the bottom of the mountain where Moses had ascended. He had gone up to talk to God. And it was a long conversation. And so his return was delayed. While Moses was up there, God was giving him what we call the Ten Commandments and giving instructions for building the tabernacle, that mobile worship space, that mobile sanctuary that was really a tent that they could take down and set up as they wandered in the wilderness and made their way toward the promised land, toward Canaan. But while they waited at the bottom of the mountain, they started to worry because Moses hadn't come back. And they had no idea when Moses would return. And they waited and they waited. And as they waited, they became more and more afraid. There's a lot of fear in our society as we wait for things to happen, wait for things to change. We are afraid in this time of wilderness and in which we are experiencing natural disasters in the forms of fires and hurricanes, not to mention other things. I think there was a flood a while back. There is racial injustice. There is social unrest. There is pandemic. And there is political angst and division. And a lot of worry a lot of worry and anxiety. And so it's natural very often to do the kind of thing that Israel did in the wilderness as they waited at the bottom of the mountain for Moses to return and for something to happen and something to change as they were worried about the future. And what they do is they decide to take matters, even to take God, into their own hands. They go to Aaron, and they want to make a god of their own, or make some representation of the Lord God, and then attribute to that representation the power to save, the salvation that has happened in the past, and the possibilities for the future. So Aaron calls for them to give their gold rings, the gold earrings that they are wearing. And they take it to Aaron, and he fashions it into a golden calf. You know, the calf and the bull were deity images in Canaan, the place where they were headed. So it made sense to choose something like that. And they said, these are the gods, these are your gods, or rather, this is the Lord God who, who delivered you from Egypt. He's finally with you again, even if Moses is not. And they worshiped. And they partied and celebrated a festival to this Lord in the calf. And God was none too pleased. I think that we make our own golden calf in this day of anxiety and fear as we wander around in this wilderness of natural disaster and pandemic and politics and injustice and unrest. And the calf we fashion to give us a sense of confidence and hope. The calf we fashion to give us a sense of strength, I think, is anger. It's prevalent in our society. We get angry about the pandemic and about what's done. We give or not done. We get angry about politics. We get angry because of our fear about the future. But anger helps us feel strong and feel a little more confident and not weak and afraid. And we, so often at least, sanctify that anger with a sense of the holy. We say that we are, we take the attributes of God's strength and power, or God's rightness and truth, and put it onto our anger to justify how we feel. And we make it a kind of idol. And we make it a means, or try to make it a means of our own salvation or security in this wilderness. The Apostle Paul refers to in his letter to the Philippians, a passage that Carol just read, about two women, Euodia and Syntyche. They were strong and hard workers in the life of the church in that Greco-Roman city of Philippi. They had worked alongside the Apostle Paul. They had been faithful to the Lord. But for some reason, they are at odds with one another. And Paul implores them to be of the same mind. I suspect that in their varying opinions, or their perhaps oppositional opinions, that each of them thought that she was right, the other was wrong. And just like you and me, you know, we tend to think that if we are right, that of course is God's opinion, and so we're right with God. But Paul implores them to be of the same mind in the Lord. In other words, not agree with each other about whatever this opinion is you have, but find your common ground in the Lord Jesus. Find your common ground in God. Because that's the source of rejoicing, and that's the source of peace. He says to Euodia and Syntyche, and really all of the church in Philippians, and in fact, the church in all times and places, set your minds on whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure and pleasing, pleasing to God, that is, whatever is commendable. If there's any excellence, if there's anything worthy of praise, set your minds on these things. And friends, the anger that is in our society is worthy of no praise. The division in our country . The anger displeases God. We have people who act in anger, and an anger that is a kind of hatred. Where we have people who did not wish the president well in his COVID-19, diagnosis. And we have anger and hatred where there were people who plotted to kidnap the governor of Michigan and do God knows what. That's where it can lead. This is not true. This is not honorable. There's nothing pure about it. Certainly not worthy of praise. God calls us in the midst of our fear to hold on to our faith and to know that God is still with us. That's the beauty of the faith that we have in Jesus Christ, who has promised to be with us always, even to the end of the age. Jesus, who is Emmanuel, God with us, even if we can't see. We don't need a God that we can touch or control or put our hands on, because our God is greater than that. And our God is a God of love and a God of peace. And the Apostle Paul says to pray and give thanks. And the God of peace, whom we know in Jesus Christ, will keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. We don't need to bring our gold, to bring our resources, to bring our energy. We don't need to invest in hate, in the golden calf of hate that gives us a sense of control or a sense of power or confidence. In the stewardship season, we might consider the next time in the wilderness that the people bring their gold. It's for the building of the tabernacle. There's such a big difference between building a golden calf and saying, "This is your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt," and worshiping something that you can control. And no, there's a difference between that and building a space that facilitates the presence of God and the ministry of God among you. In the season of stewardship, we might consider that as we bring our gold, we bring our resources, our financial resources, our time, our energy, our love, not for building something that gives us a sense of control or gives us a sense of strength, but gives us a sense of love and encouragement and facilitates the reminders that God is with us. And God remains with us wherever we wander in this world. The God we know in Jesus Christ, who is the very peace, the very shalom of God, Jesus Christ, who destroys our hatred with the peace we know from His love. That love is born out in God's not turning against us when we turn against God and build our golden calves of hatred. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee, even when we turn. Friends, in the midst of this wilderness, our only option is the love of God in Jesus Christ, who is always with us, whose coming was accompanied by words of "fear not." Jesus Christ, who is with us, and not only full of grace, but creates in us forgiveness and graciousness, faith, love, and hope. The hope of the God we know in Jesus. The peace in Him, the peace of Christ, the peace of God that passes all understanding will hold us close and remain with us, not only now, but always and in the life to come. Thanks be to God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us join in singing, "You Are Near." Stand amazed at your great love. Now, I want to share a few announcements with you. We start this week, or this coming, as this week, as we move into this week, we start our stewardship season with the theme, growing against the odds. Because there's so much that's been happening in the life of our congregation that we want to celebrate. And this is during a time when we thought we might have shut down or at least slowed down, but in so many ways, we haven't slowed down and we never shut down. And so we want to celebrate that and celebrate God's faithfulness and your faithfulness during this time. And so you will hear about all the things that have been happening, and we will celebrate those things. Our next week, we have our first stewardship preacher, and it is the Reverend Aaron Ochart, whom some of you know as AJ. He grew up in our congregation and has served and went to Princeton Seminary and has served churches in South Carolina, and is now 2 weeks from today will be will be installed officially as the pastor or as a pastor in Louisiana. So we are excited that he will join us next week, October the 18th. Now, speaking of stewardship, one of the programs we have to help generate revenue that you can participate in is Amazon Smile. And I know that I've been signed up for that quite a while and have been doing it wrong. And I lament all the revenue that might have been, that has been lost to the church because I was doing it wrong. Steve Zietzlag is here to fill you in on that and how to participate in Amazon Smile. Steve is always with us as part of our tech team. And so you are getting ready to get a scene from behind the camera at his house. And so Steve, welcome.
Morning. Thank you. Yeah, I wanted to remind you that the church is participating in the Amazon Smile program. And what the Smile program does is it benefits the church through contributions made by Amazon for every purchase we make on the Amazon site. Now, the challenge is, as Bill pointed out, well, it's fairly simple to solve. If you just go to smile.amazon.com, and if you've never done that before, the first time you do that, they'll say, what organization do you want to contribute to? And you, from a list, select Lake Arrowhead Community Presbyterian Church. And from that point on, your account is signed up to contribute a small portion of every purchase. And by the way, it's not your contribution, but Amazon. So you don't pay any more, but Amazon will make a contribution for everything you purchase on that site. So go to smile.amazon.com one time. It will hook you up with the right organization. And the good news is, from that point on, if you go to Amazon with your app on your iPhone or Android, it will also be set up to automatically connect to the Amazon Smile program, and you will make contributions automatically. So the good news is it works on the app as well, which most of us are all using these days. So if anybody has any questions about that, feel free to shoot me an email, and I will be happy to help you out. Thanks again, and back to you, Bill, assuming that I can do this replay spotlight. There you go.
Thank you, Steve. And remember to not goof the way I did, and I usually use the computer and not the app on the phone. To not goof the way I did, go to smile.amazon rather than just Amazon. And it'll work just fine. Okay, again, thank you, Steve. And now we have a couple of announcements from Carol Stanley. Oh, gosh, she needs my mic.
Good morning. I've become aware that some of you do not know about some of the programs currently going on at the church. And one that is very exciting is our new horse ministry. And about 6 weeks ago, Laura Miller came and met with us and told us that she heard one of Bill's sermons about Reuben and trying something new and giving gifts to God. And she had two horses that she wanted to share with our church and with the children. And so now for over a month, we have been taking children to Laura's house where they get, half of them get a lesson, and then they switch off and they go and they learn about the horses, taking care of the horses, brushing the horses, and riding the horses. We have 18 children currently participating in this program, which mostly goes on our Wednesdays. We've done some makeups on Sundays. And a couple of the youth has come as well. So we are so grateful to Laura. Kathy Porter has been helping her as well, and her daughter Lauren. But just grateful for this new ministry that has just been perfect for our church family during COVID. The other thing I wanted to let you know is that Trunk or Treat will happen this year. It will happen on Friday, October 30th. We are looking for folks that will come. We will do it socially distanced. There will be masks. We will be trying to keep 6 feet between the trunks and the kids getting candy. And we're also looking for things to give that distance, whether gutters or some carpet rolls or different things that, we can perhaps put the candy down.
You mean funnel the candy?
Funnel the candy, yes.
Or have a tube?
You can throw the candy or you can funnel. So we're
like
looking for some
candy duct.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. We're looking for some candy ducts. So if you would like to help out, it is October 30th at 5:15. And we will follow that with a drive-in movie. So if you want to bring, just if you don't want to do the candy, don't feel comfortable with that, you can still come and participate in the drive-in movie. Just bring a sack dinner to eat in the car.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Now let us join together in the prayers of the people. Great and gracious and glorious God, we thank you that you gather us together to worship you. We thank you that in Jesus Christ you free us from the bonds of slavery, but you also free us from the bonds of anger and hatred. Though there is righteous indignation that is good and right, we pray that you will deliver us from turning that kind of thing into that which does not please you. We pray, O God, that you will open our hearts to one another and that you will fill us with faith. We pray, O God, that you will delight our congregation in the joy of giving even more than usual during this time of this season of stewardship that we begin. We celebrate, O God, with joy, the birth of Cyrus Edson Gramp, who joins his 4-year-old brother in this life and in the family of Mary Justine and Armin Lanyon and Lesage. We thank you for this new grandson for them. We thank you, O God, that Sue Grant's eye surgery went well. And we also thank you that Tom Secor is doing well, and continue to pray for him. We pray for Carol Banner, and we ask that you will bless her chemo treatments and that you will work your healing in her body. And we pray for Helen Richardson also as she deals with cancer and as she knows your presence and your love with her in a special way. And we pray that you will bless her with the ability to sense our own prayers. We pray for Fred Becker in his pain, suffering from arthritis, and we pray that you will encourage him and empower him during this time. We pray for our world and for all the angst that our nation and world know, and lift up the church around the world and in our country and in our own congregation as in the various ways that this angst seeps in. But we thank you for your faithfulness and your love and the grace that we know in Christ Jesus our Lord, who taught us to pray using these words: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now, let us join in the giving of our tithes and offerings. I remind you that when you write a check to the church, to please write it as LACPC. That or the full name, Lake Arrowhead Community Presbyterian Church, which is way too much to write, are the only ways that the bank will receive the check and not force us to return it. So LACPC is your best bet. No other kinds of abbreviations are possible. Now, let us present our offerings to the Lord.
Let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin.
Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for all your good gifts. All gifts from you are good. And we pray, O God, that you will bless this which we give, and we pray that you will delight us with your peace and your love. This we pray in Jesus' name, our Lord. Amen. Well, Alleluia means praise the Lord. So with the song Alleluia, let us join in following Paul's instruction to rejoice in the Lord always.
Your love is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain underneath my feet. Your love is a mystery. How you just relieve me when I am surrounded. Your love carries me. Hallelujah. Joy that's growing deep inside of me. Every time I see you, all your goodness shines through. I can feel the scars all rising up in me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing.
Go from this place in the name of the true representation of God, the one who is God, God's very self, Jesus Christ. Go in Christ's love and Christ's peace, the one who keeps our hearts and minds, the one who is with us. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. And let all God's children say, amen. The peace of Christ be with you.
Also with you.
Let us share that peace with one another.